Welcome back, Zero K fans, to Nanolays at Dawn. I remain your host, ShadowFury333, and this next match will be between Dinefriend and 400 on Eye of Horus. Dinefriend going immediately for the Hovercraft Factory, which actually makes a lot of sense, while 400 going for the Cloakybot Factory, which I put forward that this map is the largest map that is a flat map, well, relatively flat map, that works for bots. So both players going for factories that make a lot of sense on this map. Hovercraft is one of those factories that you don't see a whole lot because it usually ends up being a bit all or nothing, especially daggers. The way daggers fight, they either one-shot their target or they die. Because they have such low fire rate, and while their damage is high, their fire rate's low, and their splash damage being line-based means that they might get lucky and kill an entire force, or maybe not lucky, but the position might work out properly, or it might not. In this case, it's gonna not work out that well. Which is unfortunate, because those glaives were in a very beautiful line, but the dagger just didn't happen to be in the right spot when they started fighting. At any rate, we'll probably see Dinefriend switch over to halberds quite quickly, just because halberds are the best. Maybe scalpels as well. Scalpels are good too, but halberds are pretty much the best unit in the Hovercraft Factory. They are way too defensive to easily take out in any context. That being said, though, Dinefriend going entirely for the daggers. So 400 at this point, getting some rating in there. Oh, I know what they're gonna do. They're going around the side, back of the mountain, and I think Dinefriend realizes this as well, positioning their daggers to intercept. And that interception should be successful, in fact. Not getting a whole lot of splash damage out of things, but the daggers are still dealing enough damage that the glaives cannot do much. Two glaives do survive. They should get around here. Actually, no, one glaive? No, both glaives getting around. Dinefriend reversing course, going around the other side. In fact, going for a counterattack with those daggers. Another trio of daggers in their main base to help defend. That is the only thing they have, but that should be more than enough. 400 basically unable to deal any meaningful damage here, and yeah, there it is. The last glaive forced back again as Dinefriend goes for a counterattack. 400 will probably keep that glaive in the back just to keep a bit of a thorn in 400 in Dinefriend's side. A Dinefriend, on the other hand, coming into a well-prepared 400's base as a warrior is just waiting for these daggers and wants to tear them to shreds. Already one goes down, the second one might have gone down, but luckily for Dinefriend, just the right positioning to make it not do so. Unfortunately for them, they did need that fourth one for the one shot on the metal extractor. And this is what I mean. Daggers don't do a whole lot because of their fire rate. At this point, the warrior is just gonna kill the dagger. Best thing the dagger can do is get behind the, there it is. Let's say get behind the metal extractor and let the warrior try to kill both of them. But no, 400's commander in the right spot to basically prevent any major damage. That is not that important, though. Dinefriend still ahead economically. They didn't manage to lose all that much, and 400... I mean, they did stop the attack, and the daggers, of course, are worth something. But it wasn't a free assault. I mean, the only thing is the Conjurer did still live, so rebuilding is not going to be that difficult. I would say it broke relatively even. Dinefriend's economy is still ahead. 400, however, is going to get a nice chunk of reclaim, pays for the metal extractors that were destroyed. Not a huge amount, though. And Dinefriend did make good use of that time, expanding towards the center of the map as well as the northeast, while at the same time, 400, they are not expanding that quickly. Come to think of it, it's worth pointing out that 400's starting position is a starting position that's more difficult to expand from. Like, where Dinefriend is starting, that is a fairly typical start position on this map for 1v1. Where 400 is starting, that is an uncommon second spot in 2v2. Normally it's like this area for 2v2. Actually, no, never mind. It's about equally common for the corners. But the center is the 1v1 starting location. That is where you generally go. It's a lot easier to expand to the sides. It's harder. The mountain, or the little valley here over to the northwest and southeast is the worst spot to start out in because there's no way to get into the center easily. At least where 400 is expanding to the center is not difficult. It's just a little bit further away to expand to the southeast. Where Dinefriend is, however, it's much easier to expand to both sides. Dinefriend, however, going for the more typical northeast expansion. So nothing really out of the ordinary. It's just that Dinefriend does have an easier time setting up a position to defend the northeast as opposed to 400 trying to defend the center. 400 will end up falling back into a corner. At any rate, that's not super important since 400 is set up. I mean, they're getting themselves some defenses over in the line in front of the center expansion. They are fine. Dinefront ahead, though. Dinefront is ahead a little bit. Positionally, they are ahead. Economically, they're falling behind as Dinefront does not take the south or the center east, where 400 does take the center west. So as it stands, 400 is gaining a bit economically. They do need more energy, though. Both players actually need more energy. Dinefront also needs a little bit more production capacity, and 400, aware of their energy deficit, but a little bit late on there, does manage to rebuild somewhat. They are going to excess metal, however. Dinefront, on the other hand, not as likely to do so, which is an opening. This is a very important opening as well. Dinefront, they need to get a couple of characters. Okay, they have the caretaker in the main base, they have the commander in the main base, they can use up most of this metal. They need one more solar collector, and that'll do the trick. 400, on the other hand, they need 5 more solar collectors to start spending the money they have. So Dinefront, despite the lack of metal, is still ahead production-wise. Not to mention because 400 only has the factory itself. They don't have additional construction help from caretakers or any conjurers. And at this point, it's starting to pay off as Dinefront taking the center-west side of the map, which the advantage that 400 has basically not doing much, not coming to fruition at all. 400, however, finally does get those solar collectors. They just need additional production. They only have 20 metal per second going into the factory compared to Dinefront having 0. Dinefront is not building anything here. I don't know why. They're going for the gunship plant, which is something, but they still could be building stuff in the meantime. They're accessing metal, and that nullifies the advantage they had. Like, 400's mistake with an excess is no longer relevant. 400 now has enough production capacity, and they have enough build power being used. They aren't accessing themselves. They're expanding quite a bit. 400 is getting the economic advantage, and Dinefront, the only hope they really had at that point was to basically not lose the production advantage. At this point, though, they've also lost the economic advantage, in large part due to this one glaive. The thorn in the side! I'm a bit surprised Dinefront didn't set up something to deal with that, like set up a defender on this hill to help just flush out the glaive. And it, having not done so means 400 is able to wreck Dinefront's economy from behind. That is huge. It's gone now, but still, that was 8 metal per second. No, that was 10 metal per second, because these are slightly more valuable than normal. That was 10 metal per second that Dinefront lost, that 400 basically took for free, or at the cost of one glaive. So that early raid still panned out. And that's the thing. That's why I point out the fact that it's important to get rid of those raiders, because 400 just kept that there. Dinefront didn't think about it. 400 thought about it. 400 used it. And now 400, with that distraction, forcing Dinefront back into their own base on the defensive as 400 continues to expand. Hasn't he taken all the center, though, but still, expansions continue apace as 400 basically doesn't have anything stopping them right now, as Dinefront is worried about 400's forces. Also revealing the gunship plan a little early. There's only the one rapier. Sorry, 2 rapiers. Third in production. 400 got valuable information there. Knowing that there's an air force coming in means that they can build up gremlins, they can build up razors, they don't have to worry about anything because they know, oh, Dinefront is going for air. And 400 with the economic advantage is going to easily be able to set up their anti-air as they need it. They could do it right now, actually. They aren't, somewhat surprisingly. And they could also, they need more energy as well, which would, hey, that actually really need more energy. At this point, though, it doesn't look like they're worried too much about using any dedicated anti-air. The Rockos will not do the job. Not against rapiers easily. I mean, they'll help a bit, but not hugely. Still, let's see how that goes. As expected, not managing to get a whole lot of hits in. But at this point, there's the gremlins. That's what I expected. Gremlins are up. 400 is in position to help deal with this stuff. Dinefront going for a bit of a counterattack over the eastern side of the map, but that's not coming to fruition yet as Dinefront's forces over to the western side are forced back. Reinforcements come in, but not enough. In fact, one of the only reinforcements coming in just die a foolish, worthless death. As the gremlins move forward, and continuing production from Dinefront on the rapiers is just going to feed into those gremlins. At this point, 400 is well prepared. Now, that being said, 400 does not have any aces up their sleeve, so if they're not able to deal with the rapiers effectively, if they're not able to deal with the ground forces as well, 400 does not really have any options. They're still playing on the defensive. They're just dealing with things right now. If they manage to switch to more offensive play, then I could see them taking this match. Mostly they're relying on reclaim, actually. This entire reclaim field over to the western side of the map, that is the thing that's been keeping 400 in this game. That and Dying Ferns accessing, but mostly just the fact that they have a reclaim keeps them economic. That keeps them at economic parity, slight economic advantage. But Dying Ferns still has map control. They have air control to an extent. They have a bit of a production advantage, which looks like it's going to skyrocket. I mean, with the caretakers coming in, if there's any reclaim taken, that's going to be immediately used. Dying Ferns still needs a bit more energy, but they're steadily building energy. They have a fusion plant coming online, so once that's done, they'll be fine for energy for the rest of the game. It's just a matter of stopping Dying Ferns from taking the rest of the map, and at this point, Dying Ferns just expanding quickly enough that it doesn't matter. Like I said, 400 had reclaim. They kind of lost reclaim. Might be trying to retake reclaim, but they lost all the easy stuff, and all the hard stuff is hard because it's inside of Dying Ferns' base. So at this point, Dying Ferns is... oh, they're at a solid lead. Solid around the back here with the rapiers is going to have a bit of a hard time coming in. I think... nah, it's going to be fine. It'll take care of 3 or 4 metal extractors. Should be able to get rid of a bit of the power infrastructure or at least slow it down a bit. The gremlins will be a issue. Not a particularly major one. An inconvenience more than anything. Only 2 gremlins, so it's... it is a problem. Some rapiers will die. But it doesn't look like Dying Ferns too worried about that. Oh, no, they are. What? Dying Ferns, why are you going next to the gremlins? That is going to lead you... that is going to kill your rapiers. You do not want that. What are you doing? Keep going. Forward is your only option, even if it is death. At least you'll kill things in death. Or at least the rapiers will kill things as they die. So at least a few static defenses got destroyed. In fact, come to think of it, all of them. There are no static defenses right now for 400 in their main base. They're rebuilding some Lotuses, but these sides are the only things they have going for them. And also Halberds are coming in for Dying Ferns. So, as I mentioned before, Halberds are an important thing that need to come in, and they have. But unfortunately for them, they haven't done enough. Oh, that scalpel almost got lucky with the glaze, but it wasn't quite on point with the hit. Still, Dying Ferns with the economic advantage does mean that losing a few units here and there isn't the biggest deal. I say that as 400 starts reclaiming a bunch of stuff, but they also only have a few hundred metal worth of reclaim, which, while important, is basically about 30 seconds at economic parity. Not great. Not terrible, but not great. 400 has done nothing to break Dying Ferns' territory. They're working on it, though. Dying Ferns trying to stop it as best as possible with the rapiers and halberds. Actually, Dying Ferns just going for a counterattack again. Just going for the halberds. Coming in, trying to deal with everything they can. And doing a fine job of it, too. And 400 just getting rid of as much military in the air as they can, but not able to get rid of the halberds effectively. As the halberds get rid of the gremlins, rapiers are going to have a field day now that these are gone. And a few of them walking into the halberds. Oh, that is painful. Only two gremlins survive in that chunk, but there's still several more that have been produced, so it's not all bad. But yeah, in that forward chunk, there's only a couple that have lived. Now, with another 8 glaives or so coming in the main base, rapidly having the numbers diminish, with rapiers coming in to help finish them off as well, this is a bit of a preparatory strike. If there is a second set of glaives coming forward, which there is, this could work. But 400 not really managing to break anything. I mean, they're dealing some damage, but they're not taking territory. This is not territory you take. This is something you do to open your opponent up to make it easier to destroy their forces more permanently. Although 400 is still ahead, actually, with the reclaim. They have managed to retake the reclaim. That is one thing they succeeded in doing. They didn't take the northwest, of course, but they did take the center west, at least for the time being. Dying Ferns trying to take it back, moving the halberds into position to take back the center west. And if it's going to work out, it's going to work out thanks to these halberds, which are having a bit of trouble with the glaives, but it won't be too bad. The glaives should be able to... should die. The halberds won't... actually, no, there are quite a few glaives. The halberds aren't going to all die, but they are going to get scared away. About half their number destroyed in the process. Still, with Rapier support, the remainder figure, well, why not? Let's go. And that may be a mistake. Razor's coming in to help deal with the Rapiers, but it's not enough. The Razor's being open means they're open to attack. And heavy attack at that. Stardust able to get rid of more Halberds in death than in life, as four Halberds just continue plowing through into 400's base. And 400 once again at an economic disadvantage. The Chainsaw won't be able to survive the Halberd assault, and the Dante might not even be completed before the Halberds come in and start destroying everything. Although it looks like two of them are at such low HP, it's not going to matter. These two Halberds here, they're dead now. The last one's going down. Still, the Rapier's coming in on top of that, but the Gremlins will scare them off. At the same time, though, 400's getting attacked over the eastern side of the map. For a second, I thought they were doing the attacking. To an extent, they were. They were setting up their commander. Getting surrounded. 400, do they have storage? I don't know. We'll find out in a sec as the commander goes down. And no, they do not. 400 did not build any backup storage. And now they're losing the eastern side of the map. Because they didn't build backup storage. They're also not keeping their energy. They're actually fine. They didn't need the storage that badly. But it doesn't help. I mean, their storage was there. It was nice. It was energy storage. Thankfully for 400, they didn't lose a huge amount in the process of losing their commander. They lost something. They lost a forward constructor, and they lost the economy it provided. And they should rebuild the storage when they get the chance, but thankfully for them, they hadn't any metal stored, and they had basically a fully functioning economy. So, they're good. They're okay. They're not great. They're still economically disadvantaged, but they were using all the metal they had, and they're continuing to use all the metal they have, and all the energy they have. Well, not all the energy, but the overdrive works. So yeah. 400's economy was in a functional enough state. If Dimeframe were to lose their economy, that'd be a bigger deal. Or lose their commander, that'd be a bit of a bigger deal. Storage-wise, less of a big deal economically. But I don't think that's going to happen, as Dimeframe appears to be almost finishing off 400. 400's last-ditch attempt. The Dante is online. If that does its job, then we should be fine. If that does not do its job, then 400 is going to go down, and that'll be the next game. And it looks like, I mean, no problem against these. It's against the Ravagers and Levelers? Nah, that's fine. To what happens afterwards. Also, whether or not the Dante deals more damage to its own base than to the opponents. That's another concern, actually. And 400 not paying enough attention to the glaives here, finally getting onto them after losing several. And at the same time, eastern side of the map, Rapier's coming in, getting rid of Razors. Rapier's getting rid of Razors. That is a new one. I would have never expected that to happen. I mean, I realize they have the slowing effect in their missiles, but still, Rapier's against Razors is... Okay, it's a fight of attrition. The Rapiers are winning, but only really because Dimeframe has a massive economic advantage over 400. 400 not at the reclaim to work with, and Dimeframe coming in on basically all fronts with more than enough forces to deal with this. 400 has got nothing. And Dimeframe coming in here with a shot ready for nuke. What are you talking about? No, they're just teasing. There's no tactical or strategic nuclear silo here. There is, however, a lot of tanks. And those tanks are basically going to win the game. Because 400 does not have the forces readily available to stop this. They do have a few Rapiers. They managed to get their own gunship plant. That's nice. That helps. That pushes away 400. Sorry, that pushes away Dimeframe for the day. But 400's Dante is the only asset they really have. It's the only thing that's relevant right now in the game. The Rapiers should... Oh, they need to sweep forward. They need to sweep north and support the Dante. The Dante's going to die. Against this force, the Dante is over. And unfortunately for the Dante, it does go down, taking out a lot of Dimeframe's forces with it, but inside of Dimeframe's territory and with no other military assets in 400's real favor, I don't see this working out too well. I also don't see another Dante coming up, but at 400's current economy, I don't see a Dante actually being viable. Given what they have so far, from the omniscient spectator perspective, the only real path of approach is the center. And even then, that's very weak due to the fact that there's still vehicles just roaming around the map. I mean, with a Rapier... the Rapier force over to the western could actually get rid of almost everything. That would leave things open for the glaives, but unfortunately, the loss of the glaives in the south side of the map has opened things up for Dimeframe to come in, and that will finish off 400's southern expansion. From there, it's just a pretty quick matter of going over west and dealing with dealing with 400's main base. I don't know why I can't keep these straight. Just whatever. Actually, I do know why, because the main base for 400 is left of Dimefront's main base. Regardless, though, this is game. 400 is basically defenseless at this point. They have no money. They have nothing. Dimefront able to recover from that early energy stall and a slight economic disadvantage, although really, they were pretty neck and neck for the most part. A lot of that being reclaimed, most of that being reclaimed for 400. They almost had nothing else besides that. And yeah, until about the last third of the game, they were fine. But then after that point, it was over. So yeah, that's about it for that game. Kind of sucks for 400 they didn't manage to get any territory, but that was basically what I was talking about at the start of the game, that that particular position is a little bit difficult to assault from. You can't easily take the center of the map, so Dimefront basically had that for free. And given 400's position defensively, unless they manage to secure a strong position across the entire south side of the map, 400 is in a strong... they just can take this northeast. Dimefront can just take the northeast. There's nothing 400 can do about it. Or very little, and Dimefront probably knew that because... Actually, I don't know if they knew it for sure, because they took a lot of it, and they fortified it quite heavily. But yeah, Dimefront didn't really have to worry about that. For 400, they basically had to go kind of wrap around the center and go up, or maybe wrap around through the main base. It's just, there's no easy way to get to the northeast, and even the center east is a little bit tricky to get to. 400 wasn't in a great position to do so. And it's pretty obvious, 400 took the west hard, pretty much never took the east. That's why I say it's important, and that's why most people probably start in the center, is because it's just easier. Not probably. That's why people start in the center. It's easier to take the sides. It's easier to deal with your opponent, whatever they're doing. Taking a side basically establishes you on that side, and your opponent figures, oh, well, I can just deal with the other side, and you can't do much about it easily. Which is true. Anyway, so the last map for tonight is going to be Lonely Oasis, featuring Gaiop against Hokomoko. That'll be up in a couple minutes. Stay tuned.